Hey guys, just a quick note that we're looking for another sponsor for the podcast. So if you want to reach thousands of NC State fans each week, reach out to me at redandwhitepodcast@gmail.com. As always, thanks for listening. Go Pack. I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. All right, folks, we are back with another edition of the Red and White Podcast. That is two for the week, and it's only Monday. I put the Big Game Boomer pod that I put out for the members early last week, put it out in the main feed today, along with the podcast ECU preview with Boneyard podcast. And boy, did that fire up the masses. Our friend Jared from the Boneyard podcast is a big fan of ECU, and he let everybody know it. It was great. It was a really good, it was a fun conversation. It's exactly what I expect from an ECU fan, and you know, a fan in general, right? That they should be very confident in their team going into the season. And he was. He is very confident in this team. I don't know if you, Zach, if you had a chance to listen to that yet, but if you haven't, it's a good one.
Yeah, and I haven't had a chance to listen to that one yet. That's on my to-do list for tomorrow. I listened to a little bit of Big Game Boomer tonight on my ride home from work. So got a couple I got to catch up on.
I thought Boomer was good.
What I listened to, I mean, the names he was rattling off of, like, you know, I thought maybe, okay, he's coming on Red and White podcast. He's gonna do his little research, but he was throwing out names on us. But then he's throwing out like Kalijah Kancey and, you know, the defensive backs for Pitt and Miami's starting tackle, you know. And I was just like, wow, okay. Because, I mean, obviously the guy does his homework. So the list that he puts out, they're educated lists. You know, he's knowledgeable, very knowledgeable.
He really does. Yeah, it really does. And, you know, sorry, Zach, forgot the intro. Zach. Will's not here. It's actually Zach. It's not baseball season, but Zach wanted to come on. It's perfect. It was a perfect fill-in. So Zach's here with me. Yeah, you know, Boomer, I thought he's very knowledgeable. You know, I talked to him even off air. We were having conversations about it. And I'm like, man, like he really loves college football, and he really puts his time into it. You know, there is some trolling going on. He openly admitted that, which I think is funny. I mean, that's what you're supposed to do. But he generally puts some time into it. And if he doesn't know, he asks people, you know, in a particular area. And credit to him, man. He puts a lot of time into it. So yeah. I was a big fan. I enjoyed that conversation. He was good.
You could tell, I mean, the way he talked about watching games on Saturday on four different, you know, three TVs and his tablet. And then on Sunday, he's going back to watch like the G5 games.
Yeah,
I was like, damn, dude, that is commitment right there. You know,
that is more dedication than I have. Yeah, we go weeks at a time without putting out a podcast. So we're only talking about one team. Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah. I want to get, somebody dropped in a message. It wasn't Ed from LA. Ed has gone AWOL. Ed, if you are listening, it's football season. We expect you back in the rotation. Philip had a comment. I'm going to play Phil's message. He wanted to discuss the running game.
Good afternoon, fellas. I was listening to your comments about the running game or lack thereof. I hope that they've worked on it this off season. We really need to have one, two, or three running plays that we know will work, that they have drilled ad nauseum, that everybody's clicking on. It just seems like we waste too many downs and expect the passing game to bail us out, and strong defense, which, you know, on the surface, that's okay. I mean, it's won a bunch of games, but, it bites us in the ass too many times. Just last year, just think about Miami and Wake Forest, and every year going back, you can find a game or two in there that we should have won. So, keep up the good work on the pod. Really enjoy it. Thanks.
I think he's right, right? He kind of encapsulates everything we've talked about before, you know, in the pod chat, on the podcast. you know, they need to be more creative in, you know, offense in general. I think, you know, we've been, you know, the common complaint is we've been, you know, running the same inside zone run plays, you know, ineffectively. We haven't been able to have big explosive plays. My question has always been, and it's probably the one question I was asked John Garrison or Dave Dorn if I got them in private. You know, the running game was last year in particular. Is it the running backs or is it the offensive line? I mean, you just had a guy drafted, you know, the first offensive player in the draft last year was your offensive tackle. Or was it the running backs, you know, lack of vision, maybe not developing into the superstar running backs we thought they were going to be? I'm not sure. I do think they need to have some creativity in the running game. I kind of expect that to be the case this year. What do you think about that, Zach? I know we've talked about it before.
Yeah. I mean, the running game definitely has to improve. You know, you can't I do think part of last year, I've heard you talk about it, you know, Bam and Ricky didn't seem – it seemed as if they were hungry in spurts, you know, and kind of after one big run, the next two were kind of like, okay, let me just, you know, get some yardage and you know – Not attacking the holes, not running hungry like what you talked about previously on a different pod. But I do think, I mean, running behind Icky, you always heard him talk, you know, you heard the announcers, you watch the run game that we had. They always ran, you know, not always, but most of the time they ran to the left-hand side. And so I do think part of it was the line and a lack of creativity, a lack of execution. But I also think that, you know, if you watch Bam and Ricky run, and then you watch when Jordan Houston got into the game, you know, Jordan was kind of, if there wasn't something there, he was trying to make something happen. Bam and Ricky would just kind of shuffle down the line. If it wasn't there, okay, 1 or 2 yards, you know. But, you know, Jordan, he doesn't have the size that they have. Houston, he's not as big as they are, but he's quick. I'm excited to watch him in the first couple games and see what he does. You know, he's quick. He's quick twitch, and he's fast. But, you know, he's got to find a way to get out of some of those shoestring tackles that keep getting him. You know, it's like, yeah. I think he doesn't have many yards after contact. You know, that first tackler a lot of time gets him. You know, but I'd like to see him, you know, I'd like to see the run game become a little bit more creative. And like the swing passes and stuff, those are extensions of the run game, but I'd like to see him get out in some space. But I think it was a combination of lack of creativity along with, I don't want to say ability, but execution along the offensive line, as well as Bam and Ricky knowing that it was their money year, you know, and you saw it in certain situations. Like I can think, you know, Bam on that one run where I think he did 2 spin moves against Carolina. Ricky had, you know, good runs here and there, explosive runs in the first half against Carolina. You know, and that's just the game that's freshest in the memory, but you just, you know, it didn't always look like there was that hunger there to keep the feet churning and to keep, you know, gain in every yard that you could.
One of the things Will and I have always talked about is I would love to see them run from the shotgun just once, like spread it out mm-hmm. wide, delay draw, something a little bit different. I think mm-hmm. Philip Danford charted it last year, the year before, where, you know, it was something absurd, like 70% of our runs were coming from the same formation. Yeah. And you're like, okay, that's pretty obvious. And I think Philip was right with his, you know, message where I feel like we weren't strong enough in the run game and we ended up throwing a lot of jump balls and, you know, waiting for the passing game to bail us out. I want to mm-hmm. see a little bit more balance. I'm with you on, I think Jordan Houston brings a different dynamic to the run game and it might even force some creativity, right? Forcing them to get him into space rather than, you know, the inside zone, which is not going to be his, you know, strong suit, in my opinion. Yeah. And then you got Demi Sumo, who they have talked about for years now, 2 years. People have just raved about Demi Sumo. He's going to be a great back. Demi Sumo's got everything. Dave Dorn mentioned it recently, and we played the clip on the last pod. he's talking about Demi Sumo being a three-tool player. And you're like, all right, man, he's hyping this guy up. So I'm really curious.
Yeah, the comment that stood out to me was he said that he thinks that Demi Sumo is going to be a nationally yeah. known type player. I mean, that's
high praise.
Yeah, that's for a guy, for a guy who hasn't taken a meaningful snap at running back, that's high praise, like you say. But, I think Will hit on it in the last pod or something, talking about when Bam was running back the kickoff against Wake Forest, Sumo was outrunning Bam. If you go back and watch that, and you're like, okay, well, why isn't this guy on the field more? I hope that it's not decoy and just talk. I would love to come out and see Houston, Mims, and Sumo, just be a three-headed monster. That would be awesome.
Yeah. I think it's going to be interesting because we've always said you need the run game to take pressure off the passing game. I think this year with Leary back there and, some proven weapons in Thayer Thomas and Devin Carter, I'm wondering if the passing game is going to help take some pressure off the run game, right? They're going to be able to stretch the field and maybe open up some of those lanes for, Jordan Houston and Demi Sumo and, Delbert Mims when you get inside the red zone. So it's interesting. I can't wait to see how it develops, right? I have high expectations for the offense. Somebody in the pod chat is bringing me down just, with their Tim Beck, who he is, and this is what he's going to run. Like, I get it, but I'm just kind of hoping for a little bit more explosive, a little bit more aggression. So we'll see how that plays out on Saturday.
But I will say, you talk about the pass game opening up for the run game. You've heard me preach this. 5-yard curls and 3-yard outs do not open up the run game.
Yeah.
If you want to open up the run game with the pass game, what do you have to do? Throw the ball down the field. You have to take shots. Yeah. If you're still running 3-yard, hooks and 5-yard outs or whatever, they're still going to be getting up close to the line. They're going to be stacking the box on you, little 6-yard slants here and there. The linebackers are still going to creep. The safeties are still going to creep, and it's going to affect your run game. But if you start taking the top off of defense, having the linebackers drop deeper into a zone or a safety, having to cover in a deep post or something like that, that opens things up for you where you start putting the ratios more into your advantage. You're getting people out of the way. And so, I understand, I'm not all every ball needs to be 30 yards down the field, but at the same time, I'm sure we'll get into this a little bit later, but you got to start taking the top off a little bit more, and that will help your run game.
Yeah, average depth of target for State has been middle of the pack. And Philip Danford from IPS had a really good thread about offensive explosiveness, and essentially his conclusion was, hey, you got to throw it vertical more. I'm like, well, no shit. That's what we've been saying for a long time on this podcast. And, as much as I hate to give Carolina credit, Phil Longo does a really good job of stretching the field for Carolina, right? They do it with Josh Down. They run him off, and they did it before with Brown and the other guy, and I can't think of their names at the moment. But they just seem to – and that's why their run game was so strong. I think it really played a part. They had that ability to go over the top of you and keep you honest. And so we need some of that, and I'm wondering if we start to see that when you have a little bit more speed on the field with Porter Rooks, Julian Gray, Keon Lassane.
Ant Smith.
I was getting there. Jalen Coit is the other one that Dave Doran keeps mentioning, which kind of surprises me. He's a little guy. He's fast. He hadn't heard much from him, and all of a sudden Dave has mentioned him like nonstop. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering, is he going to get on the field? But again, he's a speed guy. So I'm wondering how that dynamic changes. I think that's going to be one of the kind of storylines to watch, in my opinion.
I agree. But I think you get in the Carolina example you just brought up. But I think it's chicken or the egg. You had Daz Newsome and De'Ami Brown and Sam Howell just chunking it up. Okay, so did the fact that Sam was bombing 70-yard TDs open it up for Javonte Williams and Michael Carter? Or did – they're running at the beginning of the year, make the safety start to creep, the linebackers, creeping up, paying respect, but, and open up the things downfield to where safety was biting on a play action. Yeah. And it was, the corner had they had isolation with just one corner. So, I don't know. It's traditionalists will say you got to run the ball and able to be able to throw the ball, but you know, I don't know.
That's essentially what it is. Like, and that's why we've harped on the, you know, skill position recruiting. All right. The recruiting's been going well, but you got to start landing some of these skill position studs because these are the guys, you know, the Nyheim Hines of the world that help keep a, you know, defense honest. So, I wanted to get into two things. One, the conversation of the day, Rob McLam, Sports Illustrated guy, put out a question and I jumped on it real quick and then, you know, it got mixed reviews and then the next day I put out a thread about it. But his question was, would a 10-win season be disappointing? And my initial reply was yes. Anything that, you know, 10 wins is good. There's a level of success, but my initial reply was, you know, 10 wins, I'd be disappointed with it if it didn't mean we were in the ACC championship game. Right? That's the goal, right? So to me, the 10-win discussion starts and ends with like the coaches and players, their goal right now is to win an ACC championship. They're not going to settle for 10 wins. Now, it is a level of success. So if you don't make the ACC championship game, if you don't win your division and – you know, it's still a good year, but I think they would be disappointed too, to a degree, right? They're going to be happy they won 10 games. It probably means they're in a really good bowl game, but there's probably a little bit of disappointment there. I mean, this is your season, your like program, all the momentum has led up to this. And then if you fall short of winning your division, right? I think that's the first goal. I think people will be disappointed. Now you can win 10 games and win your division, but with that, we haven't seen that lately. But it is possible. So I took the question as you're winning 10 games. That means you're losing to Clemson and probably another ACC school, which puts you, you know, back in your division.
You can win 6 games and win the Coastal.
I mean, that's right. Yeah, that's what's going to happen this year. But what's your take on the 10-win conversation? Would 10 wins be disappointing?
Flat out. I mean, this year, yes. But right now, but at the same time, it's relative.
Yeah, exactly.
Everybody's healthy. You had Dave come out today and say this is the healthiest we've ever been in training camp or coming out of training camp, you know. And so it's relative. If, you know, against Texas Tech, if Leary, you know, dislocates a shoulder, all of a sudden the goals change. You know, you have to have some level of rationality there. But right now, yes, 10 wins would be disappointing. Because the way I look at it, you know, the 2002, we won 11, beat Notre Dame. Okay, cool. What happened 2 years later? I mean, what did we do 2 years later? You know, there's no lasting effect to simply winning 10 games. Who won 10 games in college football last year?
I have no idea.
Exactly. I mean, 10 wins. Okay, cool. You know, it's a talking point. That's all it is. But you know, going to the ACC championship game, winning the ACC championship game, there's no trophy for 10 wins. There's no trophy for good season, guys. You know, there's a trophy for winning the division. There's a trophy for the ACC championship. There's a trophy for, you know, and yeah, bowl game, sure, but you know, there's a trophy for CFP playoff games and participation and, you know, stuff like that, making it that far. And so with what we have coming back this year, the expectations on the program, I like where we're ranked preseason. I don't think we should be a top 10 team. I think the guys should feel like that they should be a top 10 team and that should be some edge for them. You know, you can still turn a 13 ranking into we're still being disrespected. You know, and so that they seem to thrive on that, which is good. But I think it's all relative. But yet, you know, from where we sit tonight, sitting right here on this podcast, yes, 10 wins would be disappointing. 11 would not be disappointing to me. If we go 11, I will say this. If we go 11-1, lose to Clemson, and do not make the ACC championship game, I cannot be disappointed in that. I mean, right. I don't think even if that one loss is to Clemson, you can say, damn, you know, this is, of course, in the last year of divisions, we went 7-1 in the ACC. Clemson went 8-0 or 7-1. And here's, you know, on the coastal side, you've got Miami or Pitt or UNC going 4-4 and making it to the, you know, ACC championship game to get throttled by Clemson. Congratulations. Right. You know,
You know, 10 wins, 11 wins, both of them would be the best regular seasons in school history. So, like, it's hard to say, it'd be disappointing. The conversation is more nuanced than that. But, like, off the top of my head, beginning where we are right now, simple answer, 10 wins is disappointing. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm still the goal. All the goals are right in front of you. Nothing has changed. And I think, you know, that was my take on it. Like, I get it. You can shift your goals as things go on. People get hurt or, you know, just whatever. But I wouldn't accept it right now. I'd much rather the season play out because I think we're better than that.
And I think that right there is getting down to a key issue in NC State athletics. And that's, maybe this is a whole different podcast, off-season podcast. But, you know, it being like, oh, okay, you know, well, we had this happen. Well, we had that happen, you know. All right, well, so what? Shit happens to every team. You know, you've got to pick up the pieces and make it work somehow, some way, you know, and just kind of these letting these excuses. And I don't even know if the excuse is the right word, but letting these things just kind of be the reason that we're, you know, catering to, oh, okay, well, we won 10 games, guys. You know, we've only done that one other time in school history.
Yeah.
Okay. You know what I mean? It's
settling.
It's
not, yeah.
Yeah. Settling. And, you know, you've heard me in the podcast. Or the pod chat, refuse to accept the status quo. That's what somebody said a long time ago when we were promised. And, you know, I think we're starting to get to the point where we're not doing that. We're not accepting the status quo, but we're, you know, people who don't want to accept that are being called out for it. And I don't understand that.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. I think it's an interesting conversation. I think it's more nuanced than you can put in 200 characters on Twitter, but I want to talk about it. I wanted to explain, you know, that side of it because I get it. It would be a good season. Right. It would be historically the best season we've ever had. But I think you also have one of the best teams you've ever had. And to settle for 10 wins right now with all your goals still in front of you, I'm not going to cower and say, yeah, that's, you know, that's acceptable. Like, win the division.
I think it goes back to what I like what we're just saying is about it's relative. If you go 10-2, you lose to ECU and UNC, but you beat Clemson, finish 7-1 in the ACC, you got the tiebreaker over Clemson, you're going to the ACC championship game.
Yeah.
Are you disappointed? At 10-2
again. Now it's a good one, right? It's win the division, win 10 games, win the division. That's
So it's all. I mean, it's all about how it happens, you know.
Yeah, I agree. And that was my point. Like, you could lose Texas Tech and ECU, go 8-0 in the division, win the division, 10 wins. I'm happy with it. Right? There's a lot of ways to split that.
Here you go. Would you rather be December 3rd, 10-2 with losses to East Carolina and UNC, but you're playing in the ACC championship game, or 11-1 with a loss to Clemson?
No, 10-2. Give me the two losses to the chumps. I mean,
yeah.
I would gladly take that. Like, you can say, all right, aberration. You lose at ECU, Carolina's a rivalry game, but you went on the road and beat Clemson. 10-2, win the ACC. You're in a New Year's Six game, most likely.
Yeah,
you know, give me that all day. It would suck as a fan.
Mm-hmm.
Just to hear all the nonsense, but at the same time, Carolina's won the Coastal, you know, going 6-6 and whatever, however else they won, you know, like, give me that all day. Yeah, that's a no brainer to me.
Yeah, I agree.
What I want to play this clip for me from the Yahoo podcast, and they actually brought up, they're talking about interesting games in week 1. This was from about a week ago, but I'm going to play this right now.
I've got a good one here. So NC State, another ACC team going on the road to a Group of Five team at East Carolina to begin the season. Again, I don't know why all these ACC teams are playing road games against Group of Five teams, but
they're awesome. That's why.
but NC State, right? All the build up this year. I mean, they're like what, top 15 enter the preseason rankings. A lot of expectation on Dave Doran and them and in their staff, and they'll play East Carolina team that, you know, kind of reemerged last year, won 7 games, and it's at East Carolina. Hey, you never know. Maybe we're upset special week 1, Group of Five territory, man. Look out.
there is an internet saying for North Carolina State about their NC State, which is basically them screwing things up. You know, when they get their hopes up, they find ways to screw it up. That would be the ultimate NC State if they go and lose at East Carolina. But that is a tricky game. It really is. This is East Carolina's best team in a while.
Yep.
And,
If they have a huge year in the ACC and they're like held out of the playoff because they lost to ECU.
Yeah. Right. All right. I'm going to go.
I've got a good one here. So NC State.
I
got
to figure out these controls. I keep doing that. I think I brought this up the other day and somebody had a better response. Like, would that be the ultimate NC State move to lose to ECU, win the ACC, get held out of the playoff?
I mean, that would be one hell of an NC State move. I've got one better. Me and my dad, you know, we always talk about that, but you know, we're going to, this is my dad's, I think my dad's thought. I think it was him who told me this. We're going to beat Clemson in Death Valley on the road. We're going to drop a home game to Wake, and we're going to go into UNC and to Keenan having to win that game to go to the ACC championship and win the division. Even after we've beat Clemson, we've, you know, in Death Valley and all that. And Carolina's going to kick a field goal at the end, like a 60 yarder to beat us. And we're going to miss the ACC championship game. I think that would be like the ultimate NC State shit type thing, you know, something like that.
I think Will at one point said the ultimate NC State shit would be going 11-1 and not being in the ACC championship game while 8-4 Miami is.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, in regards to ECU, with all the hype, I mean, you just, you know, I think half the fan base would be pissed and half the fan base would just crack a beer and be like, yep, well, go call that one.
I thought it was interesting. We don't subscribe to NC State shit around here. I know people talk about it. I think what I would love to see happen this year would be to just – you know, to go out and win, like we're expecting to win, like be good, stay healthy, all those things, so that we can kill this conversation, right? Same way Clemson got rid of Clemsoning. They got drubbed 70-7 or whatever that was against West Virginia, and then they came out, and, you know, 2 years later, they win the national title, right? And they just changed their program around. I want to see some progression like that, and so we can just finally put all this nonsense to bed. I think it's so stupid. I think it probably ties more what we talked about earlier is accepting the status quo is rather than, you know, pushing for being the best. But it's just an easy out. And then the local media and the trolls online just grab onto it. And, you know, I would love to see it just die once and for all. And this is the year to finally kill it. And I just want that to happen probably more than anything.
And I think, you know, the old saying is like when you're building your blocks as of a, you know, your foundation, your team, you lose big, you lose close, you win big. Yeah. You know, those are like your four steps or whatever.
Didn't Tom O'Brien say that? Wasn't that a Tom O'Brien quote?
Was that a sniff quote? I don't know. Maybe it was.
I think Tom O'Brien said that.
Well, I like it. I will say. So, you know, but this year, you know, it's time. And I think we talked about this last year, you know, during the midseason or something like that. But it's, you know, I want to see Dave hang 70 on somebody. I don't give a damn if it's Charleston Southern. Yeah. You know, to hang 70 points on somebody and you know, that puts a swagger. That puts a program, you know, think about the Sports Center highlights and stuff. You know, 11 o'clock at night, the last game just went off or whatever. And, you know, somebody, Oklahoma State just beat the hell out of, you know, Vanderbilt, or I don't even know, 75-7. You know, people talk about stuff like that. And that gets your program attention. And some people say, well, you're running up the score. So what? So what? You think we're talking about going to the college football playoff. So there is a matter of perception here. Yeah. You know, there is a matter of how good are you really? You know, you're not going to get into the college football playoff beaten. You leave yourself open-ended to like a Baylor being there at the end, Oklahoma State, and you're vying for that fourth spot, and you beat Charleston Southern 31-7 instead of beating them, you know, 65-14. Yeah. You know, that 65-14 looks a lot different. And people, that attracts fan bases, that gets people talking. is stepping on somebody's throat, running up the score, for lack of a better term. And so I think that is a way to kind of kill that. And also, Wake Forest has been the bugaboo on this, where we get up, we run the ball, we don't step on the throat, and they've come back and they've taken it from us twice.
Yeah.
Twice. And both of those years, those were defining games where NC State shit could have been finally put to bed.
Right.
Those were your chances right there, but we didn't step on somebody's throat. We didn't air the ball out. We got conservative. We turtle shelled. We crapped our pants all the way down both legs and laid the egg. And that's where it keeps repeating itself. State has the ability to control that. Doran, Leary, the offensive coordinator.
Tim Beck.
They have the opportunity to control that by simply manhandling teams. They have the talent. They have the depth. Do it. I think NC State football put out a thing today about ask Dave Doran a question. Did you see that?
Yeah, I did.
I responded. I said, are we scared to score 60? We have the depth. Step on the throat. Run it up. You can't – Leary's not going to New York. Us averaging 30 points a game.
Yeah,
of course, they didn't ask that question, but – it was the NC State football account. I was like, well, maybe he'll read it. I like Salty Dave. Get Salty Dave. Get Dave Salty at me. That's fine. Be like, I'm going to show this chump on the Red and White podcast that we can hang 60. I'm like, hell yeah, you can.
I agree. And we've talked about it before. And I think that, when I mentioned ECU, no doubt I got a couple mentions of, hey, I like ECU. They put up 70 in Carolina a couple of years back, right? Yeah, people remember that. They remember that. It was, 70 to 47. They don't care about the 47. Somebody hung 70 on Carolina. It happens. That conversation comes up. We talk about how do you improve skill position recruiting? Well, you put some highlights on the internet, right? You get some highlights on ESPN of, guys running deep touchdowns, right? That's – I want to play for that guy. I want to play for that team, right? I want to be on ESPN. I want to have my video go viral because I'm scoring touchdowns. And I think is part of it. It all plays a part in here. And I think we're kind of seeing how that develops. So, yeah, I mean, they need to. I would love to see them do it. It's different day and age. I don't think Dave would do it against Charleston Southern, but if the opportunity presents itself against ECU, I imagine they might keep scoring. They've done it in the past after the whole Scotty Montgomery thing. So
I don't know. Dave talked about Mike Houston today in his presser. And
that's true.
The respect he has. And I was like, damn it, Dave. Don't do this. I don't want you to respect him. I don't want you to respect him.
Kill him. Yeah, I agree. ECU put out some quote, or Pirate Radio put out some quotes from some of the players. I thought this one was this one was interesting. Xavier Smith, I'm not even sure what position he plays for ECU. Respectfully, ain't nothing NC State do that concerns me. Ain't nothing their QB do that scares me. I play the game confident. I play to win.
You've got to be a cornerback. Got to be. Those guys, it's this flashback to McLeod. Yeah. Oh, my God.
My favorite response in the pod chat was after saying respectfully, he had five grammatical errors in the rest of his statement. I was like, oh, that's great.
This Talladega Nights. Yeah. He says, I said, with all due respect, means I can say whatever the hell I want. that's brave, ballsy, whatever you want to call it, to put that out on Monday, because that's going to give the guys plenty of time to read that and – it's a rivalry game.
Yeah.
It's a I won't say lose-lose rivalry game for State, but it is a rivalry game. It's in State. And, kudos to the guy for being confident, I guess. But I think he's kind of isolated in the fact that Leary doesn't scare him. Leary would scare everybody if they would just take the reins off of him and let him do his thing, man.
Yeah. Let him sling it.
Yeah.
I think, you asked me earlier, what was the hot take the Boneyard guy had? And, and the one I put out, I clipped his audio and put it out there. And I actually sent it to Dave Dorn. So I'm like, put this on loop, Dave. It said, he said, it's a rivalry game. It's not our Super Bowl. We hate NC State, but we expect to beat NC State. I'm like, all right. That's a bold prediction, bud. Yeah.
I get it. I mean, as a competitor, I guess, in the moment, you know, if you don't expect to win, why are you stepping on the field? You know, but at the same time, as a fan, you know, you're like, yeah, you got to have a little tact there. You know, I mean,
and then I asked him, that's the money, the spread's 11, over under 55. It's like, where are you putting your money? He's like, I'd put my money on the Pirates to cover, but not win. It's like, He backpedaled into that.
He didn't want the money line, huh?
He did not want the money line.
Yeah, I'd have put a little money on that one. I think State's going to cover that game. I mean, I think they're going to cover pretty easily. But
here's how I think this game is going, right? I let the guy talk last night. I didn't interject my opinion on it, but here's how I think it's going to go. I think it might be close early. I think there's emotions are going to come into play. We'll probably do some dumb stuff. I think last time we went down there and lost, we had 13 penalties. You know, I don't think we'll be that bad. But I think the emotions will run high, and I think it'll be close early. I don't know if ECU has the depth to stay with the pack if the State really puts the pedal to the gas. I mean, puts their foot in the gas and goes, right? I don't know if their defense is replacing a lot in the secondary. You know, are we going to exploit that? I think your defense in general is going to replace a lot. Their offensive line gave up 36 sacks last year, if I'm not mistaken. Uh-huh. And then the guy was like, yeah, we replaced a bunch of offensive linemen. Like, it was a good thing. So I'm kind of wondering.
You know, if you gave up, I mean, if you gave up 36, is it a good thing?
Yeah, I don't know. Like, you gave up a ton of sacks last year. And I guess it's a good thing, but are they better? Are they more experienced? Do you have any depth there? I think there's some kind of questions that ECU is going to face. No doubt ECU is going to score. I think they've got a couple playmakers that are good. I mean, they got a fifth-year quarterback who someone in the pod chat say looks like a 45-year-old father of four from Minnesota. And I was like, that's a pretty good description of him. But he's a fifth-year quarterback. He's a guy we recruited heavily. Dave talked about him today. They liked him because he's a power runner like Jordan Lynch. He's likely going to have all of the passing yards in the ECU record book, you know, mostly because he gets a fifth year from COVID. But he's a good player. He's a competitor. They've got two really good running backs. You know, so I expect them to score. I don't expect it to be a shutout. I don't know if they can hang with State if we don't do dumb stuff.
Yeah.
If they can hang with us for 60 minutes, right?
From my perspective, like, just, you know, where I sit looking at our team, looking at what I will be disappointed if they score more than 14 points. I think that they will move the ball. I think that they'll have some drives where they move the ball, but I think just the experience on our defense and the veteran leadership is going to keep them out of the end zone a good amount. That's not to say maybe I shouldn't say 14. You know, I think they'll get a few field goals or something like that. But if we give up on defense, if we give up more than two touchdowns to ECU, I will be, you know, I'll be like, we got to tighten this up. This isn't what I thought. I mean, I would love for us, you know, last year, USF, I think we came out and won. I can't remember what the final score
45,
was.
45-7, like I think.
45-7. You know, I would love to see us do that to ECU. That, you know, USF was below ECU, in my opinion, last year, especially at the end of the year. But I would love for us to come out, and I would love to see that defensive effort with 7, 10, 14 points, something like that. But I would love to see our offense hang a 60 burger on ECU. You know, to me, you go down to Greenville and you win, you know, 62-14, 60-10, something like that. That's like, okay, we're cooking with something here. You know,
and yeah. So, 42-17 is kind of where that would be like, all right, we went down there, handled our business. ECU scored. I get it. They're not a chump team.
Yeah.
But, you know, 42-17 is pretty dominant. I like that. I'd like to see that.
I'm one of those guys. I just come in and I just want to, you know, I'm like, this is, show me how dominant we are. Don't get, you know, it's like, what is the assistant coach in Remember the Titans? I don't want them to gain another yard.
Yeah.
All out, you know?
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how that plays out. I go back and forth of whether I'm nervous about this game. You know, there's some – the state fan in me is like, eh, I don't want to go to Greenville, you know. But then the rational fan in me, a rational person in me is like, we should be better. We should be a lot better than they are, just given on, you know, the talent discrepancy, you know.
The talent discrepancy, the return, the previous starts.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it shouldn't be – it shouldn't be close, but you know, who knows? It's football.
State also announced today that we have signed a 2025 and 2026 agreement with App State. And let's see. So we are going to, in 2025, we're going to open with ECU at home and then go to App State, Campbell, and then at Notre Dame. That's our non-con. In 2026, Florida at home, Richmond at home, at Vanderbilt, and Appalachian State at home. So we signed a series with App State and ECU, essentially. They announced that today. How do you feel about playing App State and ECU?
I mean, if you win, it's great. If you lose, it's terrible. I mean, like, what did you say, 2025 we get App State and ECU?
Right.
I mean, you drop both those games, your in-state recruiting is about to take a hit.
Right.
You know, I think App State's a good program, you know, but it's, again, it kind of gets back into that, is it a situation where it's a win-lose or a win-win, lose-lose, you know, all that type stuff. I think, I don't know, I see both sides of it. I think it's good for football in the state of North Carolina. Which is, you know, continuing to grow. But at the same time, what benefit is there really to State? Not if they don't win big against ECU and App State, what benefit is there?
Yeah. You know, Carolina goes to App State this weekend, and
God, I hope they beat the brakes off of Carolina.
Yeah, I mean, App State's got a real chance this weekend. I'm curious about where the programs are in, you know, 3 years. Does App State continue to be a strong program? Are they going to be able to maintain this level? I don't know. ECU, they're going to fluctuate. Who knows what, you know, Mike Houston might have a good year this year and somebody might come get him, or they could just struggle like some people are predicting. Anything could happen at that point. I don't mind playing App State. I just don't. There's no benefit to playing ECU. It's their Super Bowl. We've mentioned it before. Like this is what they live for. This is the game. They're not getting excited for UCF or Cincinnati or, you know, Tulane or anybody else in their schedule. They're getting fired up for this game, right? They want to win this game.
Yeah, you look at App State. You know, I think so. App State plays Carolina this week.
Yeah,
and I think next week they go to Texas A&M.
Yeah.
I think that's right. So, you know, I mean, like you said, this is ECU's Super Bowl. You know, they got Cincinnati, and Cincinnati's been good. They made the CFP last year, whatever. But, you know, this is the one that really means more to ECU. App State's got the in-state rivalry type deal, but, you know, at least they play more than one, you know, P5 type high risk opponent every year. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I do. Well, Zach, this weekend, football is finally here.
Finally. Showed you my setup, man. I'm so excited.
I know. It looks nice. I do have a question about your grill behind you. So I'm, and this is for everybody, so anybody out there can answer this question for me. I got a 15-year-old Weber. It's struggling. I've had to replace all of my boards and panels and burners multiple times. I think it's about time for me to upgrade. I have a Kamado that I use for smoking, or if I want to do, you know, high heat sears or anything like that. I need something that I can do like quick cooks on, and you know, I just don't feel like messing with the fire. like something propane. What's that behind you right there?
So I just cooked pork chops on this, and this is a charbroil.
Okay.
And so I had to look to make sure because I had a Weber. But I mean, this, I've had this for 2 or 3 years now, and I'm all the time cooking steaks, pork chops, deer meat. I'm all the time cooking out here. You know, it's, I like it. It's, if you get, if you've had a girl for 15 years, man, yeah, it's time though. Time to bite that bullet, I think.
I put a lot of work into things, kept her alive, but I think it's time for me to put her out to pasture. And I've gotten some recommendation for like Holland Grills and Wilmington Grills. I don't need a big one or anything fancy. I want something that's going to rely. I'm obviously going to keep it for a long time. So I know there's some people out there that are some serious grill fans. Let me know what your suggestion would be for a grill for like my second grill, right? Something I can, you know, heat up, propane, whatever I get. I got both if I want to smoke something, but I need something else. I thought about just getting a Blackstone.
Yeah, that's what we were talking about that in the pod chat the other day.
Yeah,
I think that's going to be a Christmas ask.
Yeah, I might get one of those. I think I could probably do everything I can do on my Weber on it, and then anything else I can use a Kamado. I don't know. I want to know what people think, because that's the kind of question I've had running. And your grill over your shoulder there reminded me. I meant to ask it last week.
Yeah, I'm sitting out on the deck for those of you listening at home. I'm showing Evan. I got a TV mounted out here, fire pit, grill. I'm ready to roll. College football's here. So I got to ask you, I can't remember if you and Will talked about it. So what's your season prediction? What's your final record prediction? Did you and Will talk about this yet?
Yeah, we did last week, and honestly, I forgot what I said. I think I said 11-1.
Okay.
You know, like I don't think there's anybody on the schedule that I think will be favored in every game but the Clemson game. Mm-hmm. Like I legit think – I don't know if there's anybody – on the schedule that really is going to be, you know, I'm going to say disclaimer, assuming we stay healthy, all that stuff. I don't think there's anybody on the schedule that scares me, right? I know there's some, you know, trap games, as people say, but the way the schedule sets up, everybody has a tough game before or after us, right? You know, I don't like going to Clemson. But they got Wake before us. They've got Florida State after us, or we got Florida State after them. You know, there's just everybody's got something going on. And I don't know. I'd love to see Clemson lose a game early on or lose a game in the league. So it kind of helps us out, kind of gives us a little cushion there. But I still feel like, you know, being logical, we're not going to be favored in that game. We'll be favored in the rest of them. So like 11-1, I think is – It's hard for me to fathom as a State fan. Like I'm predicting 11-1, and I'm like genuine on it. I'm not just optimistic April like I was last year, the year before. Like I think they're good enough to be 11-1, and the only real obstacle is Clemson, and then doing what you should be doing in the rest of the games. Mm-hmm. Right? I think you know Texas Tech's gonna be a tough game. Florida State is getting a little better. Carolina's a rivalry game. You know, there's all of those. You get Wake at home. You get BC at home. You know, if I had a trap game, it'd be Syracuse. We always seem to need some dumb stuff to win at Syracuse.
Yeah.
And then at Louisville. But Louisville's like, it's the end of the year. They could be firing Satterfield by then. You know, I'm not a believer in Malik Cunningham. Mm-hmm. So I don't think they're good enough for me to say, you know, they're going to be favored over us. So 11-1 is where I am at this point. And a lot of it, you know, comes down to the Clemson game. It really does.
Yeah, that's where I'm at too. Is 11-1, and I do think that my one L is different though. I think we lose in Keenan. I do. Yeah, I think we go into that game undefeated.
They should have beat us last year, right? It took a stupid miracle to win that game. So
absolutely.
That would be unbelievable.
Yeah, I just think that's the way it works out. And that's, you know, I mean, how many games, what, State's won like 11 out of the last 15 or something. I can't even remember.
Yeah.
But how many of those games that should State have really won? You know, I mean, stuff like that happens in these rivalry games, and it seems to happen a lot with State Carolina, you know, and that's good. That's a good thing, you know, let you puff your chest out for a year and then tuck your tail for two. You know what I mean?
So. Yeah, I mean, as much as we dog them, they're not terrible. They're not a garbage program. They have talent. My question is, like, is Mac Brown going to be, you know, 6-6, coach your first job at the end of that year? You know, or is he going to be forced? I don't think they'll fire him, but I think forced retirement is probably on the table. He's old. You know, there's all kinds of questions there. You know, you don't know what the landscape's going to be. But to be honest, if we're 11-1, lose to Carolina, still take it. Means we're in the division, win the division, AC championship game. You know, probably playing Miami or, you know, maybe Carolina again. You get a second shot at it. But, you know, bittersweet, but still gladly take that right now.
Yeah, we're getting way off topic here. Did you watch the Carolina game the other night?
I did.
Dude,
I think Drake May is actually pretty good.
He looked. I will say he looked, you know, decent. He looked serviceable, but because of who they were playing, and the situation that FAMU was in. But you know, I mean, as a freshman coming in slinging five TDs, I mean, I don't care who you're doing that against. It's still good. You know, it's better than throwing five interceptions.
I mean, he looked strong. You know, the irony is, you know, FAMU held out people because of academic issues, right? I mean, I think that's...
Yeah, Carolina probably had more people ineligible than FAMU, but they just didn't hold them out.
Well, now the story came out. Pete Thamel just wrote a story, like, I think literally an hour ago, that the FAMU players are coming together about the athletic department did them disservice by not having enough, you know, support staff and whatnot.
I saw something about that.
They're blaming their eligibility on. I was trying to find the article real quick, but I can't seem to get it.
Well, they said I read it. Go ahead.
Yeah. No, you're good. I think the heels looked okay. I think their defense is still in question. They're going to come back. Mm-hmm. You know, they're playing with that Chizik, which is very much the Huxtable mentality of bend but don't break. You know, so is their offense going to be able to, you know, sustain them? I think it's going to be the question. Josh Downs just got hurt. You know, I think that's something to keep an eye on. I mean, it's only an ankle, so he'll be back. But, yeah, they'll score. I think the defense is in question. I think they have some talent. I don't know what we get by, you know, seeing them play Florida A&M. I keep forgetting the name. Florida A&M. You know, so
I want to see Josh Harris lined up on Travis Shaw. I know they both play defense, but I looked at there one time. And I saw number four, the biggest dude on the field wearing number four. I think that's Travis Shaw.
Yeah,
and I was like, that's a big boy right there. But I'd love to see him and Josh Harris just go head to head.
One looks more fluffy than the other.
Yeah,
we'll say that
a lot more.
One looks more fluffy than the other.
Yeah.
But all right, Zach, I'm going to let you go. I appreciate you joining me. And
yes, sir.
I know you're excited about football season. I'm excited. I think this weekend is going to be awesome. Y'all, if you want to get in the pod chat, support the site, support the pod, redwhitenetwork.com. As always, Zach, appreciate it. Have a good one. Go Pack.
Go Pack. I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wind.